I spent the first 3 months literally lying flat on my back with traction on weights on the back of my head to try and fix the spine. No movement, no sensation, and just like that, everything was gone. Dignity, self-esteem, self-respect. I had no desire to live. I had no oomph. It was just like, right, this is life now. I knew I was going to live because that was apparent. I didn't know I had a life. I didn't know there was going to be a life at all. It was just purely 3 months later. How I quite got through that, I don't really know. Some days you just woke up and it was nice to have felt support from family and friends or hear stories from other patients. But it was some days I just didn't want to wake up. You just didn't want to wake up and face it, really. Just go, right, this is what kind of life am I looking at? So I did 3 months on traction, and then slowly got me into a wheelchair, which was fun. After being laid flat for 3 months, they had to slowly lift my body up and kind of slowly get me up so I could actually be seated. And then it was like getting dizzy and light-headed, and I thought, oh no, get that down. And then eventually I got so that I could actually sit and go down to physiotherapy and start doing physio and start working on the movement and stuff that I did have. I was in hospital for 8 months. I think the best part of 8 months I was actually in hospital. There was very little they could do for me. It was learning basically, you know, how to accept the injury and how to be washed and accept how to be dressed and how to be fed, all these things, because I just couldn't do it myself. It was a case of not learning how to do it, it was a case of learning actually how to deal with it, really. Which was, well, horrendous, really. This is the first, I think that this picture is probably about 8 or 9 months. Well, I've left hospital, and this was about 8 or 9 months after leaving hospital. I don't know if you can see on the wheels that we put rope on the wheels, because the initial goal was obviously to try and build enough strength in my arms and get enough movement in my arms so that I could actually propel the wheelchair. That never happened. Set the goal. It just didn't happen. Just didn't gain strength, just didn't gain enough mobility. So we always had to know that the option was going to be relying on a power chair. And then the sensation came back kind of left hand side first. So I had to kind of learn to do everything left handed with very limited movement. So I borrowed a chair from hospital. Well, let's just say they found me in bushes, and I ended up in lifts, and stuck in corners, and all sorts, and it was so frustrating just not being able to have enough strength to move a power chair. You think, God, is this it? Is this going to be my life? You know, how pathetic is this? I can't even drive a wheelchair, let alone a manual chair. I can't even steer and control a power chair. So the environment all over the place, I'd go outside just for a bit of fresh air and just like couldn't get back in because the doors would be shut, or I'd crash into a bush, or you name it, but the environment all over the place. Which was all fun. Go to the next slide. So that kind of explains a little bit about the actual injury itself, and a bit about the time in hospital. Is there any questions at that point? Okay, so obviously, so the process then was I spent 8 months in hospital, and then it was like, right, okay, now what do they do? They sent me to a nursing home, and at the time, we didn't know how long that was going to be. my goal was to live independently with care. That was always the aim, that was always a goal. There was no way I was going to live out with my dad. That was just not an option, it just wasn't going to happen. So the aim was, right, okay, I need to live independently, we need to sort out a care package, and we need to figure out the best route to do that. So they put me in a nursing home first, and we didn't really know how long this process was going to take. As it turned out, it was about 4 or 5 months, so it wasn't actually too bad. But then, it was kind of at this point, because while I was in hospital, there were people I'd been around were people that were spinal injured. Some were neck, some were back, some were injuries, car accidents, some people broke their necks putting washing lines out, or whatever, some people were just stupid accidents, but the only people of disabilities that I'd really been around was spinal. And the last few months of the rehab was quite funny, because people were coming to terms with things, and they were accepting the disabilities, and the level of humour was just, it was insane. It was so funny that everyone was just kind of laughing at their own situations, and you thought, okay, that's kind of my outlook on disability. So then once I actually got into a nursing home, and I sort of started meeting people that had strokes or brain hemorrhages or car accidents, and that was the kind of first point where I actually felt a little bit of hope. And it was the first point where I actually felt that I'm glad of what I've got. I've got my senses, I've got my speech, I've got my communication, I'm breathing on my own. The mobility, yeah, I've not quite come to terms with that yet. But it was kind of the first time where I actually thought to myself, you know what, I don't know what life's going to be like, and I don't know what's around the corner, but at least I can talk, at least I can hear, at least I can communicate. Whereas there's people in there, you know, blinking for contact, and people that weren't able to communicate, and they weren't able to do anything themselves. So it's kind of at that point I kind of started looking at disability in itself in a different perspective, and it was kind of probably the first time I thought to myself, okay, you know, I'm pretty thankful for what I have got. So I moved into my house. As it turned out, it was just over a year, just after my injury. And I moved into a little bungalow where I'm still living now in Bradford. And we adapted the bungalow out, so I've got an overhead tracking hoist so I can be hoisted in and out of bed. We put a wheeling shower chair so I can do the toileting, showering, etc. I interviewed people for care staff, so we've got a care team up and running. All in the process, and I'll talk about the skiing holiday shortly. All in the process, I kind of had it in the back of my mind that I was leaving the nursing home, going on a skiing holiday, and then I was going to be setting up home. So that was kind of the process, and I'll talk about that more shortly. So the idea was that once I got home, it was alright, okay, start living independently with care. So we have to have carers and set it all up. We got home up and running. I managed to get a chair, a power chair on the NHS. It was rubbish. It did about a mile. It was okay for getting around the house. It was okay for, you know, nipping to the shops or going to the cinema or doing something. But it had no warmth in it. And then we was kind of like, how do we get about practically? While I was in hospital, the only way to get me in and out of the car was how what we call the slide and transfer, because basically I'm dead weight, 6'4", so you'd have to kind of put my legs in, put a board under my bum, and then kind of slide it in. There was a few times I ended up on the floor. So that wasn't safe. That wasn't realistic. You needed two people just to go out. It wasn't good for my dad. So it was what we did vehicle-wise, is we bought an old ambulance, and we put some ramps up to it, bought the clamps, and basically adapted no landing, but it was the best part of £1,000 for a vehicle. Later on, and as time's gone on, you know, we've invested in, this is my second chair like this, and I'm on a second wheelchair accessible vehicle, but you just drive the vehicle in and away you go. So as time's come on, we've found different ways to make things easier to adapt and get about. Okay. Right, so it was kind of at this point. So I'd been through my injury, I'd gone through everything, set up home, I'd set up my care package. It was a big question of, like, okay, now what? I had no idea what I could do in my life. I had no idea what I could offer. Self-esteem was pretty much as low as you can get. So we'd covered the basics, we'd covered the foundations, and okay, right now I've got home, I've got transport, I can move around, I can do bits and bobs. But what am I going to do in my life? On consideration, the first option was like, well, okay, I was always sporty, I was always into my activities, and I was always active before my injury. And I kind of thought, okay, so it would be nice to go back into that kind of field and look at coaching or doing some kind of work around sport that would keep me focused. So I went to the local college and explained the situation. I wanted to do some study. I wanted to kind of look at some kind of sports coaching course. Just flick over and think I've got a picture of Dave. Yeah, this is a picture of me and Dave. Dave was my tutor. Dave had never worked with anyone in such a severe disability as myself. Dave had never worked with anyone actually in a wheelchair. And he said, okay, we'll give it a go. This brought up so many questions. It was like, okay, right, so you want to do a sports coaching course and you've got a physical disability. Yeah, right. So there was all kind of questions. At this time I had a power chair, so I was mobile myself. It was like, right, okay, how do we get me involved? How do you get me physically involved in the games? How do you get me doing a warm-up? How do I explain to someone what they need to be doing for that particular sport? We found ways of adapting. Best way, obviously, communication. We found ways of having pictures where I could kind of get my carers to point things and go, you know, this is a coaching tip, do this. I had to really learn, because of where I damaged myself, I breathe from a diaphragm, and I don't know if you can really tell from here, but I breathe from lower down, I breathe from a diaphragm, not my chest. So when I actually lay flat, my chest doesn't move, it's all from a diaphragm. So this meant that quite early on, I was quite quiet and I couldn't actually project my voice, and I couldn't really speak very long and I'd get out of breath. You know, 10 or 15 minutes and I'd just be out of breath. So I had to learn to kind of project my voice, be more vocal, be more confident in my communication, and find a way of actually completing the physical course. One story that came up was chatting to someone the other day, and we looked in to do a sports coaching course. I think it was at Sheffield University, the topic being disability sport, and trying to integrate people with disabilities into sport. Okay, great. That'll be great for me and Dave both to go on to, so we can learn some tips and try and get some pointers. Got there, first thing we saw, four steps. Would you believe it? And they was like, well, what do you want us to do? It was like, well, did you not realise that four steps to a wheelchair user might cause a problem? You know, so they were trying to promote trying to promote disability sport and trying to get people integrated, and we couldn't get in the building. So we had to go all the way around the back and then wrap back around the building, back through the fire escape.
You think,
well, there's a lesson to be learned. You know, as part of some of the story is kind of, it's going to merge into different topics. Part of this course, we had to do, to get a qualification, we had to do 10 hours voluntary. And I came across a sports club, which is where I did the 10 voluntary hours. And I will talk about that more in some detail. So I'll talk about that more in detail, because it kind of, things kind of blend in together, but it's kind of hard to kind of keep everything separate at the same time, if that makes sense. So now I'll talk a little bit about backup. While I was in hospital, while I was on 3 months bed rest, and while I was in there kind of, you know, no hope, no will to live, just nothing, one of my friends made a collage of my life, and there was pictures of, you know, skating and snowboarding and places I'd been, and he put this collage up. Psychologically, I don't think it was a great thing to see, to be honest. constantly having them waking up to remind that A, I'm paralysed and never going to walk again, and every day having this constant reminder of what I did and what all I was. It took a bit of time to actually go, you know what, let's take this down. But the nurses saw it, and they saw me as being an active person, they saw me as someone that enjoyed the outdoors, enjoyed pushing themselves, enjoyed a challenge. And they just kept jokingly saying, oh, don't worry, you'll be skiing next year, we'll get you out sailing, or we'll do this, that, and the other. What? How can I go skiing? I can't walk, can't feed myself, I can't get out of bed, can't go to the toilet. And you're talking about going skiing. And there was like, oh yeah.